And we're joined by Snow Patrol, Gary Lightbody, Nathan Connolly and Johnny McDaid join us. A very good morning
good
to
morning.
You. A lovely look back through some of your work. And I tell you what, I put your new album on in the car this morning on the way in and I was crying by the time I arrived.
I'm sorry about that.
No, happy cry. Just,
in a good way.
In a good way. Really powerful stuff because it's sort of a journey, isn't it? And how time and space can change through your life.
Yeah, I think the main themes that I was writing about was how time can be mischievous. That speeds up and slows. We think of it as linear, but it speeds up and slows down to the beat of our hearts, you know, when we're feeling joy or grief or sadness or happiness or whatever we're in our lives, time will bend and twist and move and speed up and slow down. And I became obsessed by that. In writing in the lyrics, the time kind of is infused through the whole record, for sure. And love, but, you know, love's always there. And
love is timeless, isn't it?
And the fact that it's been, 6 years of time that your fans have been waiting, that feeds into it, that kind of the idea of waiting and choosing the right moment.
I think, you know, the records get made the way they get made, and sometimes the journey goes to places you're not expecting it to. But some great stuff comes out of that as well, and that all gets poured back into making the record. You know, it's heart, soul, sweat and tears. And, so that's how it got made, you know.
You make it sound like it's been a painful process, has it? Or...
it's an all sorts of process. There were times that were painful, but most of it was the bits we remember are the joy bits.
Absolutely.
Yeah. You know, the way it ended and the way we, where we got to was real joy. Probably the most joy we've ever felt in a studio.
Which is a lot down to Fraser T. Smith, who we work with. Had an amazing time. I think we all fell in love instantly with Fraser.
Yeah.
And we've become really, really close. And that just changed everything. And I don't think I've ever had more fun in the studio.
No.
So you're still having fun together?
We are.
Oh, yeah.
Very much so, yeah. It's 30 years in a couple of weeks. It'll be the anniversary, the 30th anniversary. And, still going very much, very strong.
So that's in a couple of weeks. This week, the charts. Are you constantly refreshing the charts to see?
No.
Oh,
no.
Come on.
No, really not? No, we've asked not to know. So.
Yeah.
But it must be, I mean, if it gets to number one and it's looking good, that would be fantastic, wouldn't it?
I mean,
it would be, but we're not going to tell you what, John.
It's like knowing the football results when you haven't seen the match. Said, don't tell us.
Look away now. I always wonder when there's an album that you're sort of moulding and shaping and creating over a period. Mm. What's the moment at which you all agree, right, we're ready, this is it, this is the baby?
Yeah, you'd think that would be...
After it comes out.
Yeah,
because at some point you've got to jump.
Still kind of tinkering with it until the final stages. Especially me, I'm really bad at that. I'm going, well, is this snare drum need to be down a wee bit? But, we get there in the end, but it's a long process. I think the longest process is actually when we finish recording.
Mm-hmm. The tweaks.
Mainly down to me, yeah.
What, because you're such a perfectionist?
No, I'm just annoying.
You're sort of laughing in agreement.
I think that attention to detail is important, though. But it's hard to let go because you know it's coming. So it's, you know, you're just trying to make it the best it can be.
Well, we say you've been together 30. I mean, you got together as teenagers, didn't you? So it's like you must know one another inside out.
We're incredibly close, and we talk a lot. My whole adult life's been in this band, so I've been lucky enough to share it with my
brothers.
And
you managed to rope in some famous backing singers this time, did you?
We did.
Tell us about them.
Well, there was a writer's strike on, so you know, we had to put them to work.
So it's your partners?
Yes. Sarah was in the studio at the time, and it was a choir moments, but at one point it was sounding like we were on a rowboat, wasn't it? We were just men sort of chanting, so it was just nice to have, you know, the girls on there.
And, so it's Sarah Green and Courtney Cox who were on the album. Mm-hmm. And did they ask to be on it, or did it just feel like something organic because they were hanging around?
Well, I asked Court, and I think you asked Sarah. I think it was just something that they loved the record so much, and they would have heard it around the house as we were making it, so it just seemed like a natural thing.
And they both have great voices. They both can sing, so that's handy.
Yeah. Well, that is a relief.
So were you guys in the studio when they were recording their bits? That's an interesting dynamic for partners.
Yeah, we were. I'm a kind of just let Fraser handle
that. Probably for the best.
Perfectionist Fraser gets to challenge them.
Yeah, good luck.
Yeah, but it's potentially quite an interesting dynamic, that, isn't it, when your partner's doing the backing vocals and you didn't want to correct them or anything like that.
I wouldn't dare.
No. Well, it's a good job they are good singers, and it wasn't just that asked so many times that eventually you're like, yeah, OK, on you go. And do you think with this album, you've got such an established fan base that you will be sticking with them, or do you hope to bring in new fans as well?
I mean, yeah, that absolutely. I mean, festivals were great this summer, and there was a lot of young people in the audience, you know. I was saying young people because I still think I am, but I'm not. But yeah, so it was amazing to see that, you know, just generations singing along to songs that were as old as they are, you know. Yeah. Like Chasing Cars is 18 years old this year.
And Ron's 20-something years old.
So. Kids singing that is amazing to see.
And I know you've told us you're not interested in the charts and the numbers, but, you know, I can tell you that if you look on Spotify or any other streaming app and you see the number of plays that the old stuff's had as well as the new stuff. Yeah. I mean, I think Chasing Cars is the most radio-played song of the 21st century. I mean, those numbers must be mind-blowing, aren't they, Johnny?
Yeah, I think looking at numbers can be dangerous. The metric for me is that we get on stage every night and when we play, people are singing the songs back and having a moment with us that feels special. What number sits beside that to me is kind of academic.
You're so restrained. I'll be refreshing it every 5 minutes. I think we've got a clip actually from the new album, haven't we? The Forest is the Path is the album, and the beginning was the single.
Going around the rest of the world over next year.
And is touring a different scenario now than it was all those decades ago? Because I imagine, as we all get a little bit older, we're a little bit more reserved and restrained.
There's more gaps in between the tours, between the continents, you know what I mean? There might be a month in between where there might have just been a few days before. So now, you know, we're definitely taking it a little bit easier.
A bit more mindful of the battery recharge.
Yeah, absolutely.
For sure. Yeah.
But still love it. I mean, performing live and being with the fan.
That's the everything for us. When the three of us are together playing music, it all makes sense. All the bits in between make sense.
That's really interesting. It's like that family thing. When you all get back together and you spend time together, it's you know where you are, you know where you stand, like the pillars of your life.
Well, we're best friends as well as being in a band together. And to get to do that with people you love, do something you love with people you love, is a pretty special thing.
And do you ever think back to those teenage lads and think, oh, my God, we made it, and then we carried on, and then we carried on again? Or do you just take it one step at a time?
Well, the gigs are definitely different than they were in the first 10 years. We were playing to 20 people, maybe, if we were lucky. And, you know, now we're privileged to play to, you know, tens of thousands of people. And because of those first 10 years, it keeps our feet on the ground. And you don't take anything for granted. Because I think that was the best for me personally. Anyway, I think as an 18-year-old, if I had had success, I would have definitely went off the rails. That's for sure.
Right. So you're glad it was gradual.
Those 10 years definitely took the ego down a lot of notches.
And to remember that hard work is a big part of it as well, I suppose.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, we've toured for a long, long time, and it's what we love. But yeah, you know, you have to adapt with age and maybe a little less wild than we were when we were younger.
Well, aren't we all?
It's great to have you here. Thank you so much for joining us on Breakfast this morning. And as we were saying, Snow Patrol's new album, The Forest is the Path, is out now.
And it's perfect for a little car cry. Stay with us. You're watching Breakfast.
Got some tissues for you, Nina.